Dear ladies, this week is Shabbat Mevarchim Chodesh Tevet. So don't forget, it's very important to say Tehillim on Shabbat. We have Rosh Chodesh Bli Neder, we're going to speak about it next week. Rosh Chodesh, we have next week on Thursday night, it's Erev Rosh Chodesh. Be'ezrat Hashem, Wednesday night is Erev Rosh Chodesh Be'ezrat Hashem. So Bli Neder, we'll speak. Be'emet, yeh lanu Wednesday, we have Mesivat Chanukah, yeh lanu hakol biyachad Be'ezrat Hashem. So I would like to tell you, dear women, this Parashat Shavua is Parashat Vayeshev. And it starts, Vayeshev Yaakov be'eretz megurei aviv be'eretz Knan. I have to write it on the board. Esav did only two mitzvot. One was kibud abba, which means he respect thy father, and the other one is the sitting in the land of Israel. He lived in the land of Israel, Be'eretz Knan. He lived over there. So the Midrash wants to tell us, listen, we know that Yaakov Avinu did not live in the land of Israel and did not respect his father for 22 years, and I'm going to show you why 22 years. So what does he do now? So we have a hint in the Midrash. Now he is respecting his father. This Be'eretz Megurei Aviv, it means they want to show us, the Mikra wants to show us, it's a hint that now he does Kibud Abba, respect thy father, which means this is Kibud Av. And then he's also living in the land of Israel. Zeh Yeshivat Eretz Yisrael. Eretz Yisrael. From now on, you'll see from this parasha, from Vayeshev, until the end of the book of Bereshit, everything is about the children of Yaakov. You'll see over here, everything is about the children. We'll see over here the jealousy of Yaakov, Yosef's brothers, how they were jealous. They threw him into a pit. What happened to him later? How he came back to Egypt. And in Egypt, what happened to him? How he went to jail after that. We'll see everything what happens to him, how he rolls down, and what should have happened by Hashem. This is from Shamayim. So we can see that now he does Kibud Av v'Kibud v'Yeshivat Eretz Yisrael. How many years did Yaakov Avinu did not see his father? 20. So I told you it was 22 years, but really it was 36 years. 14 years he was in the yeshiva of Shem Be'evil, yeshiva. 14 years. But this, when he studied Torah, he respected his father by doing that. So his father gets his merit by him studying Torah. So this is not yeshiva. So this is not considered. But then 20 years, you remember he was at Lavan's house. Mm-hmm. 20 years. And then 2 years he spent at Bet El. 2 years. He spent at Bet El. So how many years? It was 22 years.
What does
it
mean, Bet El?
Bet El is a place. It's a place. A city.
Well, when did he spend time? I don't know.
After, when he went back from, when he left Lavan and escaped from Lavan and ran away from Lavan. He stayed 2 years at Bet El before he went to his father. Mm. So it was 22 years. How many years did Yosef HaTzadik, how many years was he separated from his father?
Seven.
Exactly 22 years, a measure for measure, midah keneged midah. And how come? We'll speak about it. When Yosef was 17 years old, his brothers kidnapped him and sold him. Mm-hmm. So he was 17 years old. Okay? Now we know that at the age of 30, he became Mishne Lamelech, very like the right hand of the king of Paro. He became Mishne Lamelech le Paro, right hand of Paro. So now the difference is 13 years, okay, that he didn't see his father. Then there were 7 years that there was Sheva, there was enough food for everyone. Those are Sheva Shnot Sova. And then there were 2 years that they were hungry, there wasn't any food. After 2 years that there was hunger, then Yaakov and his children went down to Egypt. So how many years? It's 13 plus 7 is 20. With the 2 years of Ra'av, we can see that 22 years. Midah keneged midah. Hashem does everything. He looks at us and he says, listen, my children, I do with you measure for measure. Which means if you did something bad, Kadosh Baruch Hu, in order to clean you, because the soul can't go back under Kisei HaKavod if it's not purified. So everything that we do, we are accountable for it. So you can see that 22 years, we can see that he didn't see him.
What did
two?
I'm sorry.
Two, Shnot Rav. שנות רב, שנתיים היו שנות רב, ואז הם ירדו למצרים.
Can I ask you? Yes. What about a woman, like if she got married to another city, like she is responsible for this too?
What do you mean?
Only for the men. No. Only for the men.
If she's responsible, no. When a woman gets married to her husband, she is like the property of her husband. That's why sometimes she can't do kibud avim, because she has to listen to her husband first. You understand? The husband is the one that chalalav kibud avim shalim. That's the husband. I would like to continue.
What does the stand for?
Begil 30, הוא הפך להיות משנה למלך. So from the age of 17 to 30, Begil 30, he's the right hand of King Paro. Okay, so we have 13 years that he didn't see his father. Then 7 years that there was plenty of food for everyone. And 2 years when there was hunger. Then he saw his brothers and his father. Now let's continue. I would like to show you something. Yaakov loved Yosef. Why? Because his face looked like him. His face resembled his face. And more than that, his face also resembled Rachel's face. And you remember how much he loved Rachel. He worked for her 7 years and another 7 years. You remember how much he loved her. So he was very dear to him. But there were other things that were very important to him. You can see that the life of Yaakov and Yosef, and we'll speak in a few minutes about it, were exactly the same. We'll speak in a few minutes about it. Meanwhile, I would like to tell you what Rabbi Menachem Schneozer Mendel, Zchutot Hagan Elenu, said about it. He said, listen, Ketuv Be'eretz Megurei, which means in the land where he lives, Magor. And he says that the Shoresh, every word in Hebrew has a Shoresh, which means there's a root. Every word can. And the Shoresh, the root of this word, Megurei, of living, in Hebrew is Mem Gimel Reish. I'll write it in a different color so everybody can see. It's Mem Gimel Reish, Magor. And the rabbi says, Zchutot Hagan Elenu, that it has three explanations. One of them is really living, finding a place to live. Ze Megurim. One of them is Megurim, is really living. But the other one is Magor. Magor means fear. Magor means fear. And the other one is, another explanation is Ger, Gerut. Gerut, which means that a person is like a stranger. Okay, a foreign person. So, yes, a foreigner. So what happens, he says, the rabbi, he said something beautiful about it. He says, look at us. You will see that when Yosef went to search for his brothers, then his father tells him, go and see how your brothers are and give me good things about them. Speak about them in a good way. Find their merit and come to me and tell me what they do. So he goes, and you can see over there that it's written, Yosef Ta'a. He didn't find his place. He didn't find them. So Ta'a in Hebrew stands for, look what it says. And it will be connected to this. It says, Yosef Ta'a, he didn't find his way. So there was an angel, Ish, that came to him and helped him. And Rashi says it's Amalach Gabriel, the angel Gabriel that came to him and helped him. And the Midrash says, Maze Ta'a? So it says, the Taf is 400. And it's the Galut, the exile of Egypt. This is the 400 years that HaKadosh Baruch Hu told Avraham Avinu. In chapter 15, Pasuk, in sentence 13, he told him, Yado teda ki yezarecha ger be'eretz olayim ba'avdum v'inum 400 shana. Which means this is the 400 years that they were supposed to be slaves in Egypt. And then we can see Ayin. Ayin is 70. How many years were the children of Israel slaves, not slaves, but exiled in Babel, in Iraq? 70 years. This is Galut Babel, the exile of Babel, which is Iraq today. And then this is the 5,000, which we are in it. We are, this in the Jewish year, we are at 5,770. The Tashsa.
Okay,
Mazehei?
זה שנה.
זה האלף החמישית. האלף החמישית. This is exactly the exile that we are. This is a galut edom. This is exactly the exile that we are in it now, and we are spread all over the world. So the rabbi says, look, it's beautiful because everything is hinted inside the Torah. So the rabbi said, we live now in exile in countries that are not ours. Our place is only the land of Israel. We don't have any other place. It's our root. It's where we, you know, the land of Israel is the only land that the eyes of God is on it 24 hours a day. Only land. All the other countries, the eyes of the ministers that are under God is on the other countries. Only the land of Israel is the land that the eyes of God is directly pointed to that land. The land of Israel. And where the temple was is exactly under the chair of heaven, of Hashem. It's exactly under it. It's like it's a gate open to it. That's why it's a zchut to be in the land of Israel. So it says also, the Masechet Ketuvot, it says, Le'olam yadur adam. Be'eretz Israel, it means that always a person should, a Jewish person, should live in the land of Israel. Afilu be'ir sha'uba ovdei kochavim, even in a city that most of them worship other gods. Just imagine what it says. Be'al yadur b'chutz al-aretz, and he should never live outside the land of Israel. Afilu be'ir sha'uba Israel, and even in a city that all of them are the children of Israel. And it says shekol adar be'eretz Israel, he who lives in the land of Israel, dome kemi sheyesh lo Eloah. It means that he who lives in the land of Israel has God, because God is over there just looking on the land of Israel. And he who lives bekol adar bechutz la'aretz dome kemi she'en lo Eloka, which means he who lives in outside the land of Israel, it's like a person that doesn't have God. But why? But what do they mean by that doesn't have God? It means that God does not look directly on the other, on the countries. Because the direct gate to Hashem is in the land of Israel. That's why it's a special place. Even when we walk at Matom Mechaperet on the land of Israel, with our heels we walk on the land, it says that our sins are forgiven. At Kedei Kach, just walking on the land of Israel. At Kedei Kach, it says. And you remember what Yaakov Avinu said when he swore to God. He said, if you'll protect me while I'm going to Lavan, and I will be protected, Beshafti Beshalom El Beit Avi, and I will come peacefully to the house of my father, Vaya Hashem Li Lokim, and Hashem is going to be my God. I know I'm going Hashem, Midat Adin VeMidat HaRachamim, which means in the land of Israel, you can see the combination of judgment and mercy, and it's combined together, and it protects us. Because I told you, when Mashiach is going to come, Bezrat Hashem, amen. We are all, kol halachot, all the laws are not going to be by Bet Hillel, they are going to be by Bet Shammai. Why? Because V'shachat Hashem le'etzer hara. Because God is going to kill Yetzer Hara. There won't be any Yetzer Hara anymore. So everything is going to be by Bet Shammai. All the laws are going to be by Bet Shammai. Because we won't have a problem to fulfill them. We won't have the problem. So we continue, and you see.
Just a second. I'm sorry. I did not get what does it mean, 5,000.
Yes, me too.
This year. So it's a year.
Today, what he said with this year.
Yes, that now that we live in exile, okay. We are strangers. Foreigners,
yeah.
In lands that are not ours,
yeah.
So we always live in fear.
Yeah.
That's why you see that it's the same. The explanations of the same word. So we are strangers. We live in fear, and it's only a place to settle. For meanwhile, it's not a permanent place to settle down.
My question is why Rabbi Schneerson said about 5,770.
Because this is the longest galut exile. We are in the longest exile. Look, all the other exiles were very short. So we are for about approximately 2,000 years in exile already.
No, he was thinking that this year Mashiach is going to come forward.
No, he was explaining, giving us strength. He was, it was, the explanation is in order to give us strength, to have the strength to bear the suffering, and Bezrat Hashem Mashiach will come. We need to understand it. And where do we have the hint? We have the hint of this Galut, of Galut Edom, the exile of Edom, over here, Ta'ah, when he lost his way, when Yosef lost his way, we can see hints for the exiles that we are going to already go through. That's good. We are going to continue, and I would like to tell you, it says, why do we see, how do we see that Yaakov and Yosef were exactly the same. We can see at the continuation of the sentence, it's written, Ele toldot Yaakov Yosef. Which means the descendants of Yaakov are Yosef. So Ele toldot, it's written like this, Ele toldot Yaakov Yosef. I didn't finish with the first sentence, but I would like to explain because she asked. So Ele toldot, the descendants of Yaakov is Yosef. And the rabbi says, listen very carefully. Each one of us is called Yaakov. We are the children of Yaakov. Each and every Bnei Israel. Yaakov's name is Israel. Yaakov and Israel. We are the children of Yaakov. So it says in the Midrash, we are about, it talks about each and every one of us. Ele toldot Yaakov. These are the descendants of Yaakov. And what are the descendants? What are the fruits of Yaakov? They are Yosef. What does it mean, Yosef? It means to add, to increase. Zeh Yosef. And what do they mean when they say increase? A person, when he stands in the same place, it's like he's going, he decreases, he's going down, he's going backwards. But a person should have the will to go upwards, to increase himself, and to have a merit by doing mitzvot, by studying Torah, by opening his horizon with the Torah, by opening the path to himself. That's why it says, Ele toldot Yaakov, Yosef, he has lohosif. He has to add, he has to increase his passion for the Torah. And he has to teach other people. He has to teach them the same things that he is taught. In order that all of the children of Israel will know where they came from. It's very important. Ele toldot Yaakov, Yosef. And what? How does Yosef resemble Yaakov? Apart from his ex... External features. How does he resemble him? Well, we can see both of them were given the rights of the firstborn. We can see that Yaakov took the rights from Esav. And we can see that Yosef wasn't the firstborn. The firstborn that was from Yaakov was Reuven. But then the firstborn's right went to Yosef. Look at it, and then look, let's continue and see. Both of the mothers were karod, they didn't have children, both of them. Both of the mothers brought only two children, two sons, both of them. Look how both of them had to leave the land of Israel. They didn't have, and why did they leave the land of Israel? Because their brothers hated them. Esav hated Yaakov, and the 11 brothers hated Yosef. So because of jealousy, so both of them had to run away from the land of Israel. Look how everything resembles. It goes to the small things. It says also in the Midrash that both of them were born Nimolim, which they were circumcised already. They were born like this. And more than that, it says that both of them kept themselves very in a perfect place, which means that even though they went out of the land of Israel, they did not change their ways. Both of them were called Shalem. Shalem as a whole, because Shin stands for Shem. They did not change their name. Lamed stands for Lashon. They did not change their language. And Mem stands for Malbush. They did not change the way they dressed because they went to Egypt or they went to Haram. So they still say... גם יעקב וגם יוסף נשארו שלם, על שניהם אומרים את זה, both of them. They did not change their names, they didn't take names, like if we live in America, we take names of American civilians over here, they did not change their names, they gave Hebrew names to their children. They did not change their language, you'll see that most of us do not know Hebrew. They did not change their language. That's how we lose our tradition, we lose our ways, when we lose our name, so we don't know how to identify ourselves. The way that we can identify ourselves is by having a Jewish name, having the Jewish language, and then the Jewish ways of dressing up. Malbush, the way that we dress up. They did not dress like the Egyptians, and Yaakov Avinu did not dress up like Lavan. So you can see that they were a whole. They kept themselves. I would like to tell you, it's written by Yeshev Yaakov, God says that the righteous people think that they can sit quietly and nicely and settle down in this world. And he says, no, it's not enough for you that I already gave you the world to come? You already have rights over there. You already have paradise, and you want to sit over here without any suffering? You will have to suffer for the whole generation and your descendants. So it's written like this. Can I wipe the board? It's written like this. Vayeshev Yaakov. Katuv. Ubikesh Yaakov. Ubikesh Yaakov. Shevet. Beshalva. Yosef. Alav. I'm going to translate it in a minute. Kafatz. Berugzo. It says, look, each letter in Vayeshev Yaakov, and Yaakov settled, each letter over here, you see Vayeshev is here. Each letter symbolizes a different word over here. This is Vayeshev. All of this is Vayeshev. And then you see Yosef, Ein, Kuf, Bet, this is Yaakov. It means that Yaakov wanted to settle down peacefully. He wanted to settle down peacefully. This is Vayeshev. It's a hint from the Mikra. And then what happened? Yosef alav kafatz berugzo. He had troubles with Yosef. Yosef was taken from him. That's what, look at Vayeshev Yaakov. We already have a hint at the beginning of the parasha. What's going to happen? And what is going to happen to it? Look at with Vayeshev. Look at this. What is going to happen with Yaakov Avinu? What kind of sufferings he went through? So let's look. Yosef, I'll write the name, Dina, Esav, and Lavan. Look, dear women, every second word of the troubles and the suffering that Yaakov Avinu had in his life is written over here. We have Vayeshev, Bevav, is the second word of the name Yosef. We know that Yaakov Avinu had a lot of suffering because Yosef was separated from him. And then we see Bevayeshev, we have Yud, and he had a lot of suffering with Dina. Dina went outside, and what happened to her? He had a lot of suffering about her. And then we continue with Shin. Vayeshev, we have the Shin. Shin is Esav, it's the second letter in the word Esav. And then we have Bet Vayeshev. So he had problems with Lavan, who cheated him, who conned him. Every second letter is the word Vayeshev. Look how many hints you have inside the Mikra. And it's only the second word of this parasha. The first words Lechav, this parasha. And let's continue. You remember Yov, the story about Yov? You remember he suffered a lot. Yov, Sheloneda, he suffered a lot. Yov also speaks about Yaakov Avinu, and he says, "Lo shalat." It's written over there. Can I write it over here? He says, "I'll write it down here." Lo shalavti. Lo shakateti. And then he says, "Velo nachti." Look how all the Torah, all the Tanakh is connected. This is from the book of Yov. And look what Yov says about Yaakov. Lo shalavti, it says, Lo shalavti me'esav. I couldn't sit in peace. I couldn't be in peace because I had the problems with Esav. And then, Belo Shakateti, I didn't have any quiet because I had problems with Lavan. This is against Lavan. And then, Belo Nachti, I didn't have any rest. I didn't have any rest. It's from Dina. You remember what happened? Shimon Belavi killed all the people of Shechem. So he didn't have any rest from Dina. And then, Vayavor Oges, it means that I was tortured. I had suffering because of Yosef. Look what Yov says about Yaakov Avinu. And how does he gain any strength for that? Why does he mention Yaakov Avinu? You remember what happened to Yov? Mm-hmm. Yov lost everything. He was a rich person. He had everything. He was righteous. Then the Yetzer Hara, Satan came to God and told him, of course he believes in you. Of course he is righteous. Let me test him. You'll see how quick he's going to change his ways, he told him. He says, he has everything. Let me take everything from him. So he came to him and he took all of his possessions. He made him poor. But Yov still believed in Hashem. And then he said, okay, I will take his children. He killed all of Shalonida Metzorot, all of his children. And still Yov believed in Hashem. He took everything from him, didn't leave him. Then he said, he told God, Satan went to God and said, well, listen, but he's still healthy. He has his health. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to touch his body. He said to him, God told him, you're allowed to touch his body, but you are not allowed to touch his soul. So he went down and made him a tzora, a leopard. And he had, a skin disease. And he couldn't even sit. He had to sit inside the ground to make a hole because he wanted to, it was itching. He wanted to legared. Scratch himself all the time. Thank you. He had to scratch himself all the time. So look what happened to him. And he still believed in Hashem. So where did he get his strength from? He remembered Yaakov Avinu. He remembered our forefathers. And he said, if they suffered like this, and they still believed in Hashem, Avraham Avinu, 10 tests. He had to take his son and sacrifice him. So he said, so who am I? I will have strength. And this is what we need to have. Even though we have suffering in this world, everything is only for our best. Everything that Hashem brings down over here in this world, zerak letova. It's only for us that we will mend our ways.
Was a Jew, or I mean, his descendants were a Jew or no?
Yeah, then yes, betach. Okay. And he had a. I have to tell you, it doesn't end like this, Eyob. God gives him a lot of presents. He says, because you believed in me, and that doesn't matter what happened to you. He gives him a lot of children. He gives him money. He gives him all the everything, and more than he had at the beginning. Of course, health. Everything he gives him. Everything. He cures him. He has everything that he wishes for. And he sees at least 4 generations he sees in front of him. He was considered then a Jew. He made Shuva. He believed in Hashem. Yes. Slicha? Ken, he was Gilgul Shel Terach. I told you, remember? Yishar Koach. You remember that I told you that Terach was the father of Avraham Avinu and his wife, or Gilgul of Yov and his wife. And you know that Terach did Shuvah. We know that by the Mikra that Terach did Shuvah. He did Shuvah, he recognized Hashem. And that's why Avraham Avinu was buried with his ancestors. Because you will see that only a son, Bara Mezakeh Abba, which means, it says in the Mishnah, Bara Mezakeh Abba, which means the son can have a merit towards the father. He can save the father. But then it says about Avraham Avinu that he was buried with his ancestors, which means with his father and his grandfather. He will come to Seiva Tova, he will come to old age, and he will be their merit. And it says, the Mikra asks, how come? Because he can merit only for his father, but not for the grandfather, which means that Terach did Shuvah. Derach did tshuva, recognized Hashem. Before he passed away, he recognized Hashem and he did tshuva. So let's continue. So it says in the continuation, we can see that Ele toldot Yaakov Yosef ben 17 shana ya roe techav batzon. And it says that Yosef hotzi dibata vayav Yosef dibatam ra al aviyem. Yosef spoke, slandered his brothers. And it's very weird. It says in the Midrash, how come Yosef slandered his brothers? And I have to tell this. What did he say about his brothers? Now what happens? The truth, okay, the truth is subjective. Because a person sees the truth from his eyes. He doesn't know the whole story. In order to know the whole story, you have to ask a person. Why do you do ABC? What's the purpose? Maybe there's a good reason to do that. So what he did, he came to his father and he says, you know, my brothers are behaving towards the children of Bilhah and Zilpah, which were the maid slaves, servants. They are behaving to them, towards them as slaves. You know what Hashem told him? He says, Chayecha, he says. Chayecha. The measure by measure, the thing that you took out of your mouth, I'm going to treat you the same way. You said that they are treating them as slaves. I'm going to make you a slave. And he was sold as a slave. God told him, Mida keneged mida, measure for measure. That's why it's so important what we take out of our mouths. He says, Le'eved nimkar Yosef. Yosef was sold as a slave. And then he said, "Achai ochlim ever min achai," which means that my brothers tear flesh from a living body. They tear flesh. And you know that it's ever min achai, tearing a flesh and eating it while the animal is alive, it's forbidden, also for Bnei Noach, also for the children of Noach. Not only the children of Israel, but Bnei Noach. But the difference was that the brothers were doing the laws of the Torah. They were doing shchita to the animal, and then they are allowed to cut her while she's mefarkeset. She died. She's already dead. Once they do the shchita, the animal is dead. But still, the muscles move a little bit before she. Yes, you can see them moving, but the animal is considered dead because they did shchita on the animal. But Yosef did not understand that. He thought they should behave like the laws of, you know, the seven laws of Bnei Noach. So they are not allowed to eat ever min achai. But they already did, like I told you, that all the forefathers did the Torah. They practiced the Torah before it was given. So he came to his father and he said, they are eating part of an animal that is still alive, but it wasn't alive because they did shchita. He should have asked his brothers.
They used to say Porsche and
Ken.
It was not a real animal. They didn't do shchita.
No, it says there are a few.
They made them, right?
Yeah, like
by Akadosh Baruch Hu name. Imashima Porsche, they made them.
No, we are talking about Echila Shel Ever Min Achai.
No, when Yosef came and told to father, he saw that the animal was high and they used to cut them. But it was not a real animal. They used to make them by
Yes, yeah, there are few explanations. There are 70 faces to the Torah. There are a few explanations. It's like when you tell me that Yosef made a demon that he will sleep with the Eshet Potiphar. But still, what I wanted to say, these are different explanations. The explanation says that he saw them, and the question was either they were practicing the laws of Bnei Noach or practicing the laws of the children of Israel by the Torah. So it says in the Midrash that they did shchita. When they took an animal, they already did shchita because they considered themselves as though they received the Torah. So they did do shchita. So Kadosh Baruch Hu, God told him, Chayecha. Chayecha means it's like a vow. He says, because you said that about your brothers and you did not check it, you did not speak to them before you said that, he says, Vayishchetu Seir Izim Vayitvalu Et Haktonet Badam. So they slaughtered a goat and they put his clothes, his garment inside the blood. The same thing, because he said they ate ever min achai, the same thing happened to him. And what does this resemble? What happened to Yaakov Avinu? You remember? Why did Yaakov Avinu receive this? Why did they slaughter a goat? You remember what happened with Yaakov and Yitzchak? Yeah. You remember that when Yaakov came to Yitzchak, his mother took a goat, the skin of the goat. Why? Because it has hair. So this is measure for measure. God said, you took the skin of a goat and you came to your father with Seir Ezim. I'm going to see to that your children will take a goat, will slaughter the goat, and put your son, the son that you love the most, will put his clothes inside and come to you and tell him that you are dead. Mida, measure for measure. That's how God treats everyone. And then the third thing that he said about his brothers, he says that his brothers look at the women of the country, that they put their eyes on them. But it wasn't true again. It wasn't, they were looking, but they were looking because they were selling some of the sheep to them. So they had to speak to them. They had to have contact with them. But it wasn't a contact in order to do a sin. But he still went to his father and told him this. And God said, Chayecha sheneemar v'tisayesh et adonah v'tenei al Yosef. His master's wife cast her eyes upon Yosef, it says. Because you said that they are looking at other, measure for measure, one for one. It's like, you won't believe it. Like, it's like when you go to the store and... exactly.
But he's supposed to know that they're telling the lie.
Who's telling the lie?
Yosef.
He didn't know that he was telling. And Yaakov didn't know that he was telling it. Yaakov didn't take his slander to his heart. Yaakov loved him not for that reason. His brothers thought that Yaakov loves him because he slanders them. So his grace is going upwards and they are going downwards. I'll explain to you why they sold him. And they were very jealous because not only that, he bought a special cloth for, and prepared a special cloth, a special garment that was made out of stripes in order to give it to Yosef. He didn't give it to the other brothers. Uh-huh. And they said, wow, he's slandering us because he wants to take our place. He wants that all of the children of Israel will come from him and not from us. And we'll explain it, what happened. So you see that everything happened measure by measure, one by one. It wasn't, and it says, you see, it says, even though Yosef thought that he was speaking the truth, look what happened. By thinking that you spoke the truth, the children of Israel, the other 11 brothers, hated him and sold him, and then all of the children of Israel went to exile in Egypt. This is by thinking that you spoke the truth. This is by behaving by the measure of judgment. When you judge people, instead of looking at their merit, instead of finding the good things that you have in other people, if you look at them, if you melamed adam zchut al adam acher, then he has a zchut, he has a merit. But instead of that, he judged them. So because of that, this is what happened to him. But look at Yehuda, at his brother Yehuda. Ma betza ki na'og et achin? Why would we kill our brother? Why would we have his blood on our hands when they want to throw him to the pot, when they want to kill him? So he says, why would we do that? He tries to save him. And because of that, because he showed mercy and kindness, and because of that, he has Mashiach ben David. He received the kingdom. Malchut he received. Because of that. So God is trying to teach us that when we have mercy over other people, He has mercy over us. When we speak about the merit of other people, Hashem speaks about the about our merit. He finds the good things. Instead of judging us, He tries to find the good things that we do. Instead of having suffering, He will find a good way to give us a present because we remembered how to treat His children. Because it's not enough to go to the shul. It's not enough to pray. It's not enough to do the mitzvot. We need to show Hashem that we really truly love Him. How do we show Him that? By respecting each other, by loving each other. That's the only way. Because each and every one of us is the creation of God. And by doing that, we truly, truly love Hashem. Ba'avta l'racha kamocha. You should love thy neighbor like you love yourself. That's what we need to do. So we can see, we can continue, and we'll see. When we spoke about Toldot Yaakov Yosef, it says in the Mikra, why it's written Yosef? Why is the descendants of Yaakov Yosef? Because everything was, all the good qualities of the brothers went into Yosef, or in Yosef. For example, the rights of the firstborn that was supposed to be Reuven went to whom? To Yosef. The kingdom that was supposed to be Judah at that time went to Yosef because he became like a king in Egypt. He became like a king to his brothers. So at that time, he received Judah's kingdom. Look how everything came to him. And then we can continue the prophecy. The prophecy was supposed to be for Shevet Levi, for the tribe of Levi. And then who had the prophecy at that time? Yosef. How do we know that? Because he solves the dreams of the two prisoners that were, Sarah Ofim and Sarah Mashkim, the baker and the butler. So he solves their dreams, and then he solves the dreams of Pharaoh. So we know he had the prophecy. And then the last thing is the wisdom. Who was supposed to have the wisdom? Yisachar. Yisachar was supposed to be the Amud HaTorah, was supposed to be the smartest son of them all in the Torah. And who received that? We can see that Yosef received that. How do we know that? It's written like this. Beisrael ahav et Yosef mikol banav ki ben zkunim hulo. So it says in the Mikra, the Targum, the explanation of Yonatan ben Uziel says, ben zkunim means bar hakim. Bar hakim means a very wise child. We have ben zkunim. And then I said Bar Hakim. Bar Hakim means very wise. Hakim milshon chokhma, milshon sechel. So it's very wise. How do we know that Yosef was very wise? There's a hint in the Mikra. It says Ben Skunim. The word Skunim stands for all the six books of the Mishnah. And you'll tell me how. Look, we have Zayin is for Zraim, Masechet Zraim in the Mishnah. That's the Masechet Zraim. We have Kuf, Masechet Kedoshim in the Mishnah. We have six books of Mishnah. Nun is Masechet Nashim in the Mishnah. Yud, Yeshuot, salvation, which in the Mishnah, if you look at the Mishnah, the Masechet Shabbat, you'll see that Yeshuot means Nezikin. And then Mem is Moadim, all the holidays, Moadim. And only one is missing. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One is missing. You can't see it? One is missing. The sixth one is Taharot. Taharot means how to purify yourself. How do we know that it's added over here? Because Ben Skunim is written in the Mikra without a Vav. And the Vav is confession in Hebrew. Vav, Vav Avidui, confession. So Vav Avidui, when we confess, we are purifying ourselves. This is the sixth Mishnah. This is the sixth one. So we know that Yaakov Avinu taught everything yourself. Everything that he learned for 14 years in the yeshiva of Shem Ve'ever, he taught him. How do we know that? How do we know that Yaakov Avinu wanted to stop his suffering? Look, there's a very beautiful hint from the secrets of the Torah. It says, he went to two old people. Zaken in the Torah is a person who brought wisdom to himself. So he went to the Tuskenim, and there was Shem Be'ever. And it says in the Sod, in Be'or Torah, that if you take Zaken and double the numerical value of Zaken, you will find the secret. So let's look at Zaken. Zaken. Zayin is 7. Zaken is an old man. Kuf is 100. And Nun is 50. Together it's 157. Multiplied by 2, it's 314. You know what's 314? Shaddai. Shaddai is the name of God. Shin is 300. Dalet is 4. And Yud is 10. He taught him all the Torah that he learned. Why does he have the name Shaddai? Where does the name come from? Because when Hashem created the world and then it started spreading, Hashem said, die, stop. That's from there is the word Shaddai. So Yaakov said to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he said, he who is called Shaddai will say stop to my problems, to my suffering. This is Shaddai. Look how beautiful it is. It's from the two old people that taught him everything. Shem Ve'ever. And he passed all of the information about the Mishnah, about the laws, the oral laws that the Mishnah is written out of. And you know that then from the Mishnah they wrote the Gemara, because the Gemara is the explanations of the Mishnah. So all the oral laws that are written in the Mishnah, he taught him. He taught yourself. So we know over here that he is really Ben Skunim. He's Bar Hakim. He's a wise child. He was very smart. He was taught everything. And the brothers were very jealous because they didn't know what he knew. And we can continue and we can see that because of that, he made a special garment for him. And it's written in the Masechet Shabbat, a beautiful thing. I'll give it to you over here. It's written like this. לעולם אל ישנה אדם בנו בן הבנים שבשביל משקל שני סלעים מילת שנתן יעקב ליוסף יותר משאר בניו נתקנאו בו אחיו ונתגלגל הדבר וירדו אבותינו למצרים. Want to explain it. It's written like this. A person should never treat one son differently than his other sons. Why? For an account of two slaim, which means it's a measure of money, weight of fine wool, that Yaakov gave to Yosef in excess of what he gave to his other sons. His brothers became jealous of him, and the matter evolved until Yosef was sold by his brothers, and all of the forefathers went to exile in Egypt. So So it says a person should never make jealousy cause a reason for jealousy between his children. A person, it doesn't matter that one is studies better and the other one studies less, doesn't know how to study well. He should treat all of his children, look at their merit. He should treat all of his children as equal. He should love the good things that each one of them has in him. Because, you know, we're not the same. It's like our fingers. You can see that the fingers are not the same. But if I'll close my fingers, they are in the same line. So we need to see the beautiful things that we have in our children. And try to, you know, to flourish that beautiful thing, to make that beautiful thing blossom. That's what we need to do. Then they won't have any jealousy, and it's very hard. But then they won't have any jealousy. But because of that, all of the children of Israel went to Egypt and were in exile. And what did he make? I told you that it was a special garment with pasim, with stripes. Mm. And there are a lot of secrets in the word pasim, but more than that. The word Yosef in a numerical value equals jealousy. Yeah. Exactly. You'll see Yosef. Yosef. Yosef is like this. Equals kinah. That's jealousy. Yud is 10. Vav is 6. Samech is 80. Samech is 60, sorry. And Pe is 80. Samech is 60, Pei is 80. How much is it? So how much do you have over here? 156. So let's look at jealousy. Kuf is 100, Nun is 50, Aleph is 1, and Hey is 5. How much do we have here? 156. Yosef in the numerical value is jealousy. That's why when we want to save, Negadai Nara, when we don't want to have an evil eye, we say Ben Porat Yosef, because Yaakov blessed him in Parashat Vayeshev, Ben Porat Yosef. That's against evil eye. You say Ben Porat Yosef.
Jealousy, how to pronounce?
Sep
Kina.
Ben Porat.
Kina.
Kina. Kina. Aliyai.
Lekanot.
Not. Tseada. Alishu. That's the blessing that Yosef received from his father. This is against evil eye. We do not knock on wood. That's a Gentile's custom. Why do they knock on wood? They knock on wood because Salbuet Yeshu, they put Yeshu on a wood. That's why they not knock on wood. We do not do that. We say Ben Porat Yosef. We do not do that. If God forbid somebody did that, don't do that. Because it's not, we should not do that. They do that because he was crucified on wood.
But what does that mean, Ben Porat Yosef?
Ben Porat Yosef, the one who solves the dreams. Poter, Michel Poter. Ben Porat Ali Ain, the one that had Ain, because his master's wife, look, his mistress, looked at him. She wanted him. I will say, write it in Hebrew, okay? Ben Porat Yosef. Ben Porat Yosef. Ben Porat Ali Ain.
Israel, Nechota. Bli Ain, Aras Lo Rambo, Tesukem.
Bnot Tzada. Bnot Tzada. Bnot Tzada. Ali Shu. It's because I'll explain to you when Yosef used to walk in the street, the women were looking, they cut themselves. They used to peel vegetables and they used to cut themselves because it was so beautiful. Yeah. It's because of their eyes. So it's jealousy. It's ayin hara. That's why everything is, you see, everything you see, ayin, everything. Neged ayin hara. If somebody said that something
you Ben Porat al ayin hara. And Ben
Porat means solve dreams.
Sure.
The one that solved the dream. He had the prophecy.
What is it, the last shor or shorai?
Ali Shur.
Definition of the last line. Not
Sada Ali Shur.
The definition of
which means the women that used to look at him while they peeled. Because they were looking, everything was everything that is written here is against Ainara.
You can say any of them. Right?
You say all of them. You say it's enough to say Ben Porat Yosef.
Yeah.
Speak like it. It's enough to say Ben Porat Yosef. Okay. Let's continue, dear women.
Why he like choose him to start to teach? Like why he did not like teach both of like all of their sons? I didn't get it.
It's not that he didn't want to teach the others. They did. They were taught, but he had a special feelings towards him because that was supposed to be from Hashem. Yosef, from him comes Mashiach ben Yosef. Hashem already decided Mashiach ben Yosef comes from Yosef, and from Yehuda comes Mashiach ben David.
Okay, but like he's a father, he's a smart, he studied like Torah, and
he loved Rachel. She was the best woman. She was the head of his house, and he was her son. He was supposed to be the firstborn.
12 children, like, and he ignored 11.
He did not ignore. No. I would like to tell you, dear women, he did not ignore his sons, Yaakov. Yaakov loved dearly all of his sons, and you can see it by the other chapters that you're going to see, by the other portions of the Torah. He loved all of them. But because he lost Rachel, she passed away, he felt that this is what he has. That's what he has from her. Uh-huh. But he loved all of them. The only thing that he gave him more than the others was this garment with stripes. Yes, he gave him because he sat down and learned all the Mishnah with him. He was thrilled to study it. You know, you have a lot of children at home. Not all of them want to study. Yeah. Not all of the children want to do that. And when you have one that studies well and he's the best student in class, don't you feel something? It's not because you love him more than the others, but you feel that he gives you a merit. He makes you proud. That's what Yaakov felt. It didn't mean that he didn't love the others. They were all dear to him. And I would like to continue. Dear women, it's written, I'm going to write Pasim on the board, stripes. The word pasim. And I will show you how many secrets the word pasim has. Pasim, yes. Pasim.
Carla?
Stripes. I would. Pasim is stripes, the stripes on the garments that he had. I would like to show you. It will show us what is going to happen to Yosef. We can see a pay. The pay is for Potiphar. He is going to be a slave in the house of Potiphar. Then the Samech is Socharim, merchants, that are going to come and buy him. Yud is Ishmaelim. They sold him to Ishmaelim. And Mem is Midianim. He went through, the Midianim bought him, they sold him to the Ishmaelim. That's what happened. Look at the Pasim, we already know what's going to happen to him. But it's more than that.
Look
at Pasim. Let's do the numerical value of Pasim.
Полоски, Pasim.
Pay is 80. Samech is 60, Yud is 10, and Mem is 40. How much is it? This is 100, 190. Okay. You know what 190 is? It's Ketz. Ketz, the end, Ketz. You know what Ketz is? Why? What's the value of 190? Why I'm telling you it's Ketz? First of all, there's a hint from Yitzchak Avinu, what is going to happen to the children of Israel. Let's write Yitzchak. And I'll take out the kuf and the tzadik. I have ketz. 190. What is left over? Chai. Listen very carefully. We have chai, life. But what does it mean? What is the meaning, the true meaning of it? Listen, dear women. It means that instead, you remember I told you 400 years they were supposed to be slaves in Egypt. But they were not 400 years slaves in Egypt. They were only minyan redu, which means only 200 years they were slaves in Egypt. Tell me, 400 minus 210.
190.
190.
Oh my God.
Look, It means that bizchut, by the merit of Yosef, they are going, and the merit of Yitzchak, they are going to have 190 years less from the 400 years that they are supposed to be slaves. From this, and then they will have life. What kind of life? They're going to receive the Torah. They're going to go out of Egypt and receive the Torah. Torah is life. The Sam Chaim is life. Look how beautiful it is. 400 Shanim Shayu Yom 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 Yom. So look over here. So you see, Chai is alive. Chai is alive. They're going to receive the Torah after they will have less sentence. You know, when you are sentenced, God forbid, they will have less years, which means that God is going to take off 190 years from their sentence, and they're going to be only 210 years slaves in Egypt. But it's not the end. I have to tell you, how do we know how many years will Yosef live and how many years is going to rule in Egypt? Pay attention. How many years? Look, dear women. He ruled in Egypt 80 years. Okay. And he lived Sim. Samech 60, Yud 10, Mem, we have 40. Together it's 110 years. Yosef lived 110 years, and 80 years out of those 180, he was ruling in Egypt. Look how you, everything is in the word Pasim. We have it, we have all the hints in the word, the only word Pasim.
Can she explain? It's only one word.
Only one word. And we are studying, look how beautiful it is.
It's shock for us, it's very beautiful.
Amen.
Amen.
Then I can't sleep all night after all this.
Can I ask you, like, one night you, like, he diluted in the, for when we're in exile, like, he diluted for 190 years for all of us?
Yes. Instead of being 400 years, that's what it's supposed to be from the beginning.
No, but, like, he gave, like, this suffering for a prolonged exile for us.
Instead of having an exile of 400 years, only an exile of 210.
Yeah, but 190, like,
he took it off. Because of the merit of Yitzchak and Yosef.
But I'm not like they just keep like this diluted for the rest of their when they in exile.
No, he considered from the days of Yitzchak that exile. From the day Yitzchak was born, he considered then that like the exile started. May I understand? Yes. Let's start. Let's continue. Okay. Okay, I'll explain this. I wanted to show you how many years did Yosef rule in Egypt? 80 years, that's the pay. Pay in numerical value is 80. How many years did he live? He lived 110 years, exactly Sim. Exactly. 110 years he lived.
Она разделила, она делила 5 отдельно. Из них 80 лет, которые он... Вот это 7, да, 110 лет, он фактически умер. Ему было 110, когда он умер. Вместе это 190.
So let's continue. Одло, одло, одло. Да не видите тему. Аль тамари, кахат мы обвину. I need them to understand. Одло, we'll work together. It says, you understood, everybody. If you want, I will explain it again before we'll continue. I'll continue. Okay, let's continue. You loved it. Only one word, and it's nothing. It's only, you know, like a hint. Let's continue. It's written by Isneu Tov Lo Yachlu Dabro Le Shalom. It's written like this. Can I wipe the board?
Yeah.
Thank you. It's יכלו לדברו, לא יכלו לדברו לשלום. לשלום. It's very important. And listen very carefully. There's a halacha that we learn from this. The brothers hated him. It's written, the brothers hated him and they could not speak to him to peace. I'm telling to peace, it's because the lamed. It's two. They did not speak to him beshalom, in peace. Beshalom, it means in peace. Go in peace. It's like a go. In peace, they spoke to him, it's go to peace. And why? I'll explain in a minute, you'll understand everything. You remember the dreams that he dreamt? He had two dreams. One of the dreams was that he dreamt that there was, there were all the brothers and himself were gathering the grain, and he saw that his aluma, which means his gathering, was standing in the middle, and they were all bowing to him. All the 11 others were bowing to him. So when he tells this to his brothers, they say, "Bayomru lo achav, hamaloch timloch." He says, "Are you going to be a king over us?" Every word that they said, he said, "Ken yiratzon." They said, "Imashol timshol, you're going to be our ruler? You're going to be our king and a ruler?" He said, "Ken yiratzon." Listen, it's not the wait. So it says, and how do we know that it is true? Listen very carefully. We're going to learn halacha from this. So how do we know that those things are true? It's written, "Imashol timshol." They are saying, "Imashol timshol." And look, the first letters of each word is emet. Oh. Which means, yeah, yes, from God, it's I'm going to be your ruler. Look, emet, the first word, aleph, mem, taf, emet, the first letter of each word combines to the word emet. So he said, ken yi ratzon. And here I have to tell you something, a few things that we learn about it, and it's very important. First of all, it says, במסכת ברכות, it says, הנפטר מחברו, אל יאמר לו לך בשלום, it's הלכה, אלא לך לשלום. Which means when you say goodbye to, when you say goodbye, your friend is going away now from you, you don't say go in peace, you have to say go to peace. Why? Not בשלום, איפה זה בשלום? זה לא להגיד בשלום, to say לשלום. Why? Because when we see that the brothers said, "Velo yachlu dabo leshalom," when they said leshalom, they couldn't speak with him. It says in the midrash, you see that Yosef became a ruler, almost a king, mishne lamelech, the right hand of the king. Because when you say leshalom, you bless the person. Why? Because of the lamed. As I told you, lamed, when you write it, it's the first time writes it. It's combined from vav, which is 6, and then chaf. That is 20. It's 26, the name of God. Yud kei vav kei. So you are blessing him that he will go with the name of chesed, of charity of God, of kindness, with the merit of God. And then look very carefully. When you see when Yitro says goodbye to Moshe Rabbeinu, he says also, lech leshalom. And Moshe becomes the king of the children of Israel. But then when King David says to his son Avshalom, he says, lech beshalom. And Avshalom dies. And he loses his son. And his hair that is very long was tied in the tree, in the branches of the tree, and he dies. That's why when you say beshalom, a person, God forbid, passes away. It's a person passes away. And you have to say lech leshalom. Lech leshalom. Beshalom, akavanai alach lo'olamo. That's beshalom. Aval leshalom, you have to see that it's always you use leshalom.
Leshalom.
Leshalom. Leshalom. Lech leshalom. It's in go to peace. Not in peace, go to peace. Okay, that's the lamed. And it says, I have to tell you,
с миром и вернулись.
Leshalom zalach lo'olamo.
Теперь только в это произношение.
Ve'roim et ze lefi David ha'melech, she'amar le'avshalom lech leshalom.
Dear women,
сказать
там, я поняла, а как на русском будет? На русском,
ну, на русском нету этого. На русском нету ни Бе, ни Ле, там ничего. Езжайте с Богом, возвращайтесь с Богом, Максим.
Вот она же, она же нам здесь сказала, тут есть.
Ну, я же говорю, езжайте с миром и возвращайтесь с миром. На русском.
Лехле
шалом, как она подумает?
Да, потому что шалом это мир. Это мир фактически. Так езжайте с миром и приезжайте с миром.
We didn't sell Yosef yet. I have to continue. We are still at the beginning of the parasha.
Сахли да нас ругали, смогали как дилас кмари, вигатацилем. Лехле шалом, так что лехле шалом.
And look. From the slander of the brothers, we are learning about the merit. They couldn't speak with yourself because their heart was equal to their mouth. They were angry with him. They didn't come and kiss him and then take the knife and just put it in his back. But they were true with their heart and the mouth. It was equal. The heart and the mouth was equal. They couldn't say hello to him because they were very angry with him. So out of the lichora slander that we have in the Mikra, we can learn from them that they were true. They were true. What they had inside, they had also outside. They did not have two faces.
Like now, in this world.
In this, it's a pity. We shouldn't have two faces. Mm-hmm. It's our. We need to work on our midot, on our characteristics. And we continue, and it says, the Midrash also says, you know, ולא יכלו לדברו לשלום, it means that they couldn't speak with him because they were so angry. So sometimes it says that, the Midrash says, Chazal say, our sages say, that sometimes if we are angry about with a person, we should go to him and talk with him.
Right.
Why? Because then we can find out that what we thought, and we build a big elephant from a fly, from nothing, we build buildings, and we did a big mess out of it, we will find out that it's nothing, and we'll have peace between us. You know, when we have a problem with people, then we start to move aside from other people. We feel uncomfortable. It's not comfortable for us to go to some places because we're going to meet that person. We shouldn't do that to ourselves. We should have Ahavta l'racha kamocha. So that's why it says that even though if you're angry with someone, the best thing is to come and say, maybe I need to ask a mechila, but can you explain to me what's wrong? Mm-hmm. The best thing is to be true and to say the truth and to speak to each other, because once you speak, if Yosef would have spoken to his brothers, there wouldn't be any slander over his brothers. If he would have asked them, what did they mean? Because he saw the truth from his eyes. So in his eyes it was truth. But they knew what they were doing, so they knew their truth. So they had to communicate, to speak to each other, so they can understand each other.
There was no communication.
There wasn't any communication here, but we can continue and see. It says in the Midrash, "Amar Rabbi Levi, lo'olam itzpe adam lechalom tov ad 22 shana." A person should always wait for a good dream to fulfill itself 22 years. It says, "Minayin? How do we know that?" Sheneimar ve'achlom Yosef chalom. Yosef ben 17. It says Yosef dreamt a dream, and he was only 17 years old. The question is, how come? If you had a good dream, you should wait 22 years that it will be fulfilled. Don't discourage yourself. If it didn't come so quickly, you never forget a good dream. If it didn't fulfill itself quickly, don't discourage yourself. It can take 22 years. How do we know that by yourself? How do we know that from yourself?
It's only good dreams. The bad dreams,
they usually are fulfilled quickly. I would like to tell you, I'll speak about good and bad dreams. But dear women, listen, how do we know that? Look at yourself. When he dreamt the dreams about the moon, the stars, the sun, that they're all bowing to him, he dreamt that he was only 17 years old. He was only 17. Okay, I told you that he became the right hand of the king when he was 30, which means we have 13 years. Then 7 years that they had plenty, and then 2 years that had hunger. Together, it's 22 years. When did he meet his brothers and they bowed to him? After 22 years, the dream became true. That's why the Midrash says 22 years you should wait, and more than that. You shouldn't say a dream, a good dream that you had to anybody except for your best friend, the one that you really truly know that he truly loves you from his heart. Why? Because listen, dreams are like judgment. Dreams are like judgment. They go from the next world, they come to this world. The way that we solve the dream, it says that the dream goes after the mouth. The way we solve the dream, this is what is going to happen, because it's like we signed the judgment over here in this world. Bebet din shel mata.
So you better not to.
That's even if you had a bad dream and you tell that to a person that loves you, he will give you a good explanation that will make this judgment go to the other side, to kindness and mercy. That's why it's so important, because it says that chalom olech achar hapeh. It goes after the mouth, the way you're going to translate it.
Now that you said some good dreams is can wait 22 years. We cannot know which one is good, which one is bad.
No.
And I remember when I was
little,
grandmothers, they used to say in old times that our dreams will come true like Yosef HaTzadik. But then I heard from one of the rabbis, I don't remember exactly which rabbi says, never say like Yosef HaTzadik, because then you're going to wait another 22 years also. Say chalom, shalom, chalom, shalom, chalom, shalom.
Chalom, shalom, chalom, tov. Chalom, tov, chalom, shalom.
And then your good dream will come true faster than Yosef HaTzadik.
Chalom, tov, chalom, shalom.
It is right?
Ken.
Is it right?
Ken. Amrim chalom, tov, chalom, shalom, shalosh pa'amim, three times. Before you say the chalom.
Yeah.
Because you wanted to have a good explanation and a peaceful explanation.
So
you say three times you say Chalom Tov, Chalom Shalom before you say that. גם בשביל הרחקות וגם בכדי שהפירוש שתקבלי מהאדם יהיה טוב. Chalom Tov, Chalom Shalom. A good dream, a peaceful dream. After that, when you dream, you want to tell it to your friend. Before that, you used to say Chalom Tov, Chalom Shalom.
Have
to. Only to remember, sometimes I'll answer and then exactly. Then you say that because you need to have
it.
Leave it.
Because yes, it имеет огромное значение. А второе, прежде чем произнесешь это, ты должна сказать халом том, халом шалом.
Yeah, like a mikveh. Yes, it has the, it takes. Yes, but then you have a special blessing also.
Вообще
You always say Chalom Tov, Chalom Shalom, so Hashem will make it good and peaceful in this
world.
Yes, that's what I told her. You say that Acharei Birkat HaKohanim, you have to say that, Ken. Special one that you say that, Ken. So we can see, I'm going to continue, we can see that his father tells Yosef, I would like, after the second dream, and his brothers were jealous with him, and his father kept the thing. And that means shamar in Hebrew is the letters of shamar, rasham. It says that he wrote the dream. He knew it's true. He wrote the dream. You see, it's the same letters. Mm-hmm. Shamar kept the dream and Verasham wrote it. He wrote, Yaakov wrote the dream and wrote the date, the hour, everything, the month, the year, to see when it's going to be fulfilled.
Wow.
So I could
you know why he was so much always he was crying and...
Wait, we'll explain it. What happened? He didn't know what happened with Yosef. He didn't know, and we'll explain it in a minute. נגיע לזה. And now we can see that he sends his son, he tells him, ויאמר לו, לך נראה את שלום אחיך. Go and see the merit of your brothers, which means don't come back and slander them. Try to come back to me and tell me the good things about them. Find their merit. That's why he says Shlom Achecha Bet Shlom Atzon, which means by, it's a hint. It says by looking at the merit of a person, of the, of your brothers, you'll bring the merit of the children of Israel. Son, sheep, we are considered sheep. You'll bring the merit of the children of Israel. And by doing that, you'll bring Mashiach with you. Find the good things. We'll, if we will have over unconditional love, we'll bring Mashiach. Mashiach is going to be now. Even though I'm speaking now, he will come. If we'll only love each other, unconditional love. We won't be jealous of each other, what we have. We will be satisfied with what Hashem gave us. So he tells him, go. And why does he do that? Because Hashem wanted the children of Israel to go to Egypt. So what does Hashem do? For example, this is a parable. There's a cow, and you know, a cow has an egel. You know, a small cow? Not a chumrim egel banglit. But she has a veal. She has a veal. So they wanted the cow to work in a certain place, but she didn't want to move. She wanted to stay at the same place. So they pushed the pulled her, and she didn't move. So what did they do? They took the veal over there to that place that they wanted her to be, and he started crying. Huga! He started crying. The cow didn't have any choice. She went to her, to the veal. She went to her child. So what happened? Hashem wanted Yosef to go to Egypt because there should be the vow, the things that he told Avraham Avinu should have been. So he said, he took Yosef, he made Yaakov send Yosef alone. Because he'll tell me, he knows that the brothers are jealous of him, so he wouldn't send him alone, but it was from Hashem. That was supposed to be in order that all of the children of Israel will go to Egypt. And then there will be the exile of Egypt. It was supposed to be. So we can see that they went over there, and I won't speak about the angel. The angel looks at him and he helps him and he shows him the way. And you can see that they decide, they're speaking together, and they decide that they want to kill him. And Reuven tells them, just a minute, I'll find all the translation. Reuven tells, they want to kill him. They say, he is the one with the dreams. They are laughing at him. Here comes the one with the dreams. So let's kill him. And Reuven says, no, we shouldn't do that, he says. Vayomer elem Reuven, al tishfechu dam. Don't spread blood, he tells them. Hashlichu oto el abor hazeh, he says. And look, this is a chidush and also a hint. He says, Hashlichu oto el abor hazeh. You see the pit over here, he tells them? Throw him into the pit. And Hashlichu bo. How do we know that even though it looks so bad that they're going to throw him into the pit, we still know that Be'ezrat Hashem everything will be okay? Because if you look over here, we have Hei Zeh Chamesh, Zayin Zeh Sheva, and we have Hei another Chamesh. Be'yachad Zeh Shva Esrei. Keminyan Kama Zeh Shva Esrei? Keminyan Tov. Tet Zeteish, Abav Zeshesh. Okay, the Bet Zeshtaim.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Hi, it seems that I'm a little bit tired. Kiminyan Tov, look at it very carefully. It means even though it looks, all the scenario, all the picture looks very bad, it's going to have a good ending. It looks bad. So he tells them, Ashlichau Labor Hazeh. That, this pit. And then it says that Reuven went from them and they were sitting over there. And they still decided to kill him. And what does Yehuda comes up and tells them, no, we shouldn't kill our brother. Ma betza ki narog et achinu. Which means, why would we kill our father? And he says, ma betza ki narog et achinu. And what does it mean? He says, ma betza ki narog et achinu. And look very carefully, when he uses the word betza, why would we kill our brother? He means, why do we pray three times a day? Shacharit, mincha, ve'arvit. Bet is for boker, the blessing of shacharit. Tzadik is tzoraim. And ayin is erev, ve'arvit. He says, why are we praying? Why are we considered righteous as if we're going to kill our brother? If you're going to shed his blood over there, so he says, "Ma betza ki narog et achinu." Why would we do that? He says, "Look how beautiful it is." And ma, you remember what ma is? It's 45, the numerical value of ma. You remember? This is also a chidush. Mem is 40. Hezeb, and you know that this is the name of God. It's 45. And it's the name of God. Yud kei vav kei bimiluyotiyot. It's the name of God. Yud kei vav kei bimiluyotiyot. Yes. You remember this is 45. So he says God is going to watch us. And think about it. We are praying. It's the same question is also today. We can pray three times a day. But if we slander other people and we kill them by stealing the money or behaving not morally, it's like we didn't do anything. All of our prayers go to the bad angel. They do not go under the Kisei HaKavod. They do not go to Hashem. They go exactly to the opposite side, because also the klipa, the impurity, lives from the purity. So it lives from us. And if we, God forbid, sin, all the prayers go to the other side. So we can see, he says, "Ma betzak inarog et achinu." So why do we pray daven three times a day? And we are going to kill him. Betza ze... תדעת מה זה רודף בצע? זה כשמישהו... בצע כסף, כשמישהו רוצה משהו, he wants like greediness. זה בצע. אז אנחנו רואים, "Ma betzak inarog et achinu." And then what do? They put him really in the pit. עכשיו, I want to... והבורא כתוב כך, כתוב כך, just a minute, I'll just find it. כתוב, והבור ריק, אין בו מים. It's written that the pit that they put him inside, ריק, is empty, אין בו מים. והבור ריק, והבור ריק, אין בו מים. It says that the pit is empty, which means it doesn't have water inside. And if it doesn't have water, it's a good thing, because we know he can't drown inside. En bo maim. So why there's no water inside? So the Midrash says, look how, and we know Rashi says that en bo maim, it doesn't have water, but it has nachashim ba'akrabim in it. It has snakes. Ve'akrabim. And scorpions. Snakes and scorpions it has inside. But it's not written in the Mikra. But it is in a hint. Ein means aval, yesh nechashim. Aval, yesh nechashim. Ze ein. It hasn't. Aval, yesh nechashim. There are hints inside the Mikra. Aval, yesh nechashim. And the Midrash says, look, they didn't want, the Mikra is teaching us how to behave. They didn't want to slander the pit. So they put the good quality of the pit, that it didn't have water, that it won't drown him. They put the good quality of the pit in the writing, and then by hint they told us what it did have inside. The slander is in a hint. The as alachat kama vechama, our sages say. Chazal omrim alachat kama vechama, that this is how we need to behave with each other. God forbid not to slander each other. But only if we have to say something, only by a hint, and not, God forbid, not say something bad about anyone. If we feel that we need to say something, it's better to close the mouth. Zip the mouth, it's better. Not to say anything. That's the best thing. I have to tell you the best thing. And it says, and what did Reuven do at that time? You'll see that after that, you'll see, Ketuv kach, Veishmer Reuven ve'yatzileu mi'adam. Reuven hears that, and he saves him from their hands. Why didn't they say that about Yehudah? Because Yehudah also said, Ma betza kinarog et achinu. Didn't he save him? So why didn't they say that about Yehudah? Madu ha-mikra me'id alav. It tells about Reuven that he is the one that saved Yosef. And more than that, the first city of refuge, you know, the cities of refuge, the first one was built in the property of Shevet Reuven, of the tribe of Reuven, not Yehudah. And why did this happen? I'll give you the answer. Because Reuven said that we should throw him into the pit. So if they threw him into the pit, so the harshest thing that can happen, that his body is going to be damaged. Something will happen to his body. But his soul will still stay the same. Mm-hmm. And he's still in Eretz Knan. But Yehudah said, let's sell him. Uh-huh. And once he sold him, then his soul is in danger, because he went to Egypt, that there adultery and everything was a party in Egypt. So, lachen it says in the Mishnah that gadol שגרוע זה שמחתיו מזה שהורגו. It means that the one that makes a person sin is much worse than a person who kills a person, physically kills him in this world. Because when you kill a person in this world, you take this world from him, but he still has the next world. But when you cause a person to sin, he doesn't have the next world. You are taking from him the next world. That's why the avon of gadol, avon shel machtiyo yoter mize shorgo. So that's why the salvation of yourself is considered to is reminded considered by Reuven. Lachen it's written in the Torah, which is a very good thing. Vayishma Reuven vayetzaleu miyadam. But nobody asked me over here how come Reuven saves him from their hands. Because Reuven was the firstborn of Leah. And Reuven was the firstborn. He had the rights of the firstborn. And then we know that Yaakov took the rights and gave it to Yosef. Why would he want to save Yosef? What reason does he have to save him? If Yosef is not there, he's the firstborn. The rights come back to him. So why would he save Yosef? No, he didn't promise anyone yet. No promises yet. Why would he say, look very careful. Look how righteous was Reuven. You remember what happened? I told you that that Reuven, after Rachel passed away, he moved the bed. His father's bed, Yaakov's bed, went to Bilhah's tent. Bilhah was the maidservant of Rachel. So Reuven, he felt very bad for his mother. He said, Mele, when Rachel was alive, I understand that my father loved her more and he worked for her. But then, now his bed will go to the maidservant instead of going, even though she was now his wife, she wasn't a maidservant anymore. The bed should go to my mother. He wanted to respect his mother. So he moved the bed, ויחלל יצואי אביו. He moved the bed into the tent of Leah. And because of that, it was considered a sin for Reuven. So Reuven thought, listen very carefully, that he's not going to be part of the 12 tribes because he sinned towards his father once he moved the bed. And Reuven did not know what to do with himself. So he wanted to do a tshuva, but he didn't know that if Hashem would accept it or not. How did he know that Hashem accepted his tshuva? You know, it's so beautiful. How did he know? By the dreams of Yosef. Once Yosef said, 11 grains were bowing to me, it means that Reuven is part of them. It's only the sons, the 11 tribes. Yosef is the 12th tribe. Once he said 11 stars, Reuven is part of them. Isn't that beautiful? It's part of them. So he knew that by the dreams of Yosef, Hashem forgave him. And he's part of the 12 tribes, and he's part of the children of Israel. He's going to build the building of the children of Israel.
So he wanted to
save Betach. It was dear to him, and it was more than that. He started davening. How did they sell him? He wasn't there, Reuven. It says, part of the Midrash says, some of the Chazal says, some of the sages say that they took turns to help their father. So every time one of the sons stayed with the father, once they went with the sheep, they were shepherds, they went with the sheep, so one of the sons will say and help the father. This is what the turn of Reuven. So he went back to his father. But some say that he went and sat in a different place, far away from them, and started davening to ask forgiveness from Hashem, because he wanted to save Yosef. So he was waiting till it will be dark and he will take Yosef out of the pit and bring him back to his father. But meanwhile, Ma betza ki narog et achinu, it says the Midrash, they were sitting and eating bread. Ki betza is also to liftsoa, you know, to take the bread and to break it to two. So it's a betza liftsoa. While they were eating, there came the Ishmaelim. They came, it says, Rashi says, the Ishmaelim came and the children of Israel, Bnei Yaakov, took Yosef and sold him to the Ishmaelim. The Ishmaelim sold him to the Midianim. The Midianim sold him back to Egypt. But then some say that the Midianim saw him in the pit. They took him out and they sold him. They continued the selling. Some say that they had a quarrel with the brothers because you took our slave out of the pit, but this is our slave. So there were the sages say, all of them say, Begadol, in big, that he was sold several times. But then tell me, don't you think that Yosef, he will allow them to throw him into the pit without shouting, without crying? It says in the Midrash that he cried so much. He begged them. He begged them to have mercy on him. He said, I'm your brother. I'm still your little brother. Please forgive me. You know, I was childish. I didn't mean to tell you that I'm going to rule you. Please forgive me. What will you say to my father? They said to him. My father is going to cry over me. What will you tell my father? Please have mercy on me. He was crying, shouting, kicking, and they did not listen to him. They did not have mercy on him. And we continue and we see that he went to Egypt, and I'm going to explain, I'll have a pause over here in order to explain to you why was the selling of Yosef. And they got a srim kesef, and it says that they got 20, the amount of money, the 20 matbea, the 20 coins, and they bought each one of them shoes with that. They divided it to ten brothers, and each one had two coins, and they bought shoes with it. Na'al. It says in the Midrash, you'll ask me, but how did Yaakov did not know anything about it, and they said that a bad animal ate him. Taraf taraf. And it says, and we know that Reuben wasn't sitting with them, so there were only 9 of the brothers over there, because Yosef was in the pit, Reuben wasn't with them, and Binyamin was with his father. He wasn't there, he wasn't in the selling, he was with his father. So you'll ask me, but there were only 9. So what did they do? In order to make a cherem, they wanted to do a cherem. And they decided, we need a minyan, we need 10 people for a cherem. So nobody will be allowed to say anything to anyone else. But they didn't have, they were only 9. So they included Hashem in the cherem. That's why Hashem did not tell Yaakov. Magid barav le'Yaakov. It says in Tehillim, Magid barav le'Yaakov. Everything he tells Yaakov, but he did not tell him that. He did not tell because it was part of the cherem, of the vow not to tell anything. They included Hashem in that. So he couldn't tell him anything. And the question again comes to,
Why God agreed to go with them, like to Herod?
Because we know that it was supposed to be, they had to go to exile in Egypt. Because he told already Abraham Avinu, it's part of the fixing. Part of the fixing, it goes back until Adam HaRishon. It's part of the fixing, in order that Mashiach will come. And we had a lot of chances that Mashiach will come. Every time that we were so close, Yetzer Hara made us do a sin. We wouldn't even come to this stage. We would have long ago had Mashiach. But every time we were so close, something happened. We sinned with something. What more than we are going to receive the Torah, we are standing in front of Har Sinai, Mount Sinai. We are standing there, and instead of waiting a little bit more, the children of Israel are doing a Negel. So what more than that? Then Mashiach would have come, nothing would have happened, everything would be a kolto. Perfect. It would be a perfect world. So the question is, why did they sell Yosef? And the Midrash says that, wait, I'll explain everything. We'll do it, we'll build it together, I'll explain and you'll understand. Why did they sell Yosef? We know that Hashem built the whole world. He created the whole world only for the children of Israel. Bereshit bara Elokim. In the beginning, Hashem created. I have to tell you, Bereshit bara Elokim, it means that Kadosh Baruch Hu Bereshit, Reshit are considered the children of Israel. They are the beginning. Because of the children of Israel that are supposed to study Torah, Hashem created the whole world. So if it's for the children of Israel, what happened with the tribes? They're supposed to be righteous. They are the building departments of the children of Israel, of the whole nation. So what happened with them? It says in the Mikra, I know it's late, but I have to give you this. You have to have the explanation and a little bit about what happened with Yosef and the wife of Potiphar. It says, Bazar HaKadosh, and I'll explain to you what it says. It says, Amad Nachash, Hayetzer Hara, Lifnei HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It means that Hayetzer Hara, the bad spirit, was standing in front of Hashem. And it says to Hashem, V'tava et adin el chet mechirat Yosef. He says, God, what's going on here? I would like to see the judgment of the children of Israel. They just sold Yosef. They should be judged. And he says, isn't that written in the Torah? V'gonev ish u'mecharo nimtza biyado mot yumat. Which means the person who steals another person, his sentence is death. They stole a person, they took him, and they sold him. Look what Hashem tells them. Heshiv lo HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Kadosh Baruch Hu tells him, Katuv ve'gonev ish, he who steals ish, a man. He says, Yosef lo haya ish. Kadosh Baruch Hu says, Yosef wasn't ish. Look, I'm going to write it on the board. It's three sentences, but I have to write it.
Why?
Yeah, I'll explain. Everything we'll do together, you'll understand.
He wasn't says, a man yet.
He says, God says, Yosef is not ish. He's not a man. And the question is why? Because the definition of a man is over the age of 20. When they sold him, he was only 17. We just started. We'll do build it together. He was under. Okay, he was 17. He wasn't 20 years old. By definition, the bad spirit can't say that. Satan can't say that because he wasn't a man. Then it came again, and he told him, "Wait, but there's halacha. There's a law that says ki imatze ish gonev ki imatze ish gonev nefesh." But then it's also written that he who steals a nefesh, the spirit, which means that he who is under the age of 20. So it is, he should die. That's by law. He who steals and sells another person without him willing to be a slave. So it says also, he has. There's also a law that says that he should be dead. And it says, it's a beautiful thing. Why were the, I'm going to answer all the questions. Why were the brothers of Yosef jealous of him? So they were jealous of him for two reasons. One, because the slander that he slandered them. And then I'll explain why. And the second one is because they saw that Yaakov loved him a lot and he was keeping him because he was the only thing that he had, him and Binyamin from Rachel. And he also made him a special garment with stripes that he didn't do there for the other children. And it's not that Yaakov did not love the other children. They were very dear to him. So it says, what was the problem with the slander? They could have gone to their father and told him that it's not right, true, that they didn't mean that at all, that they did a mitzvah and they didn't do something wrong. But they thought that Yosef is telling that to their father in order to take them out of the tribes of Israel. Why? They said, God, when Avraham Avinu, they said Avraham Avinu, Avraham had the children of Keturah, Bnei Keturah, which means Ishmael and all other six children that he had from Hagar, and he also had Yitzchak. What happened? What did Avraham do? Avraham Avinu. Avraham said, they are not going to inherit anything, only the presents that I'm going to give them while I'm alive. But he who is going to inherit everything, all the Torah, and all is going to be the nation of the children of Israel, is going to be out of Yitzchak. And then what happened with Yitzchak? Yitzchak also had two children, Esav and Yaakov. And what did he do? The same thing. He said, Esav is not going to inherit anything, only the physical world. And Yaakov is going to inherit this world and the next world and everything that Hashem promised Abraham Avinu and myself. Now Yaakov had 12 children. Yeah. 12 children. And let's say I'm going to separate it. It's like 11 and 1. Okay? 11 children and they had Yosef. Okay? Yosef and 1. And they said to themselves, look what happened with our forefathers. It means that Yosef is speaking with Yaakov and slandering us in order that he will be the one that all of the Beit Israel, all of the house of the Israel is going to build on. He is going to be the building of the whole Bnei Israel. And we are not going to be included. They wanted to be part of the mitzvah. They wanted to be part of the tribes of Israel. They were very holy. They were very holy people. They wanted to be part of it. And they thought that because of Yosef, they won't be part of it. Well, he studies better than us. So I told you, even the nevuah, the prophecy, the kingdom, the rights of the firstborn, everything came to Yosef. The wisdom of the Torah came to Yosef. So they thought, wow, because of what we saw from our forefathers, what is going to happen now that we are going to be not included in the building of the Beit Israel. And that's what we don't want. We want to be part of it. We want to have the merit to be part of Bnei Israel. So the Midrash says, it's very nice. The Midrash says, like this. So they took them down. I'm going to think you have answers to everything. It says in Midrash Tanchuma, "Lechuru mifalot Elokim nora lilal bnei Adam." It's like God's intervention in the affairs of men. This is from Tehillim. It says, look at what God does, how he interferes in what people do in order that his will be fulfilled. We already know that he promised Avraham Avinu that there's going to be an exile in a land that the children of Israel don't know her. He already told him that, and it had to be now. So what did God do? He caused all this false jealousy that wasn't even in place, because if they would have spoke to each other, there won't be any jealousy. But God made it like that in order that it will be fulfilled. His will is going, Mishamayim, by heaven it will be fulfilled. And it says like that, HaKadosh Baruch Hu mevakesh lakayem gzerat yado atedaw. This is what Midrash Tanchuma says. He wanted it to be fulfilled. The gzerah, the judgment that